Hello and welcome to yet another episode of What a Hell of a Way to Die. Today, it is me, Nate, with a special guest today in studio, James Stout, journalist, historian, and cyclist, expert on anti-fascism and intrepid reporter of some of the weirdest corners of America. James, how are you doing?
I'm well. I'm good, thank you. It's nice to be back in the UK.
Yeah, so you've been in the US for a long time and you've witnessed the transformation of what was bubbling under the surface for forever. But I brought you on the show because I wanted to talk about the dreaded Antifa and anti-fascism and sort of the roots of it, because it feels to me like there's so much iconography around it, both supportive and negative. And obviously, like, I am extremely pro-Antifa, but I realize that even with doing extensive Wikipedia deep dives, I don't really know that much about the real sense of history and origins of it. And so I'm wondering, given your background, both as a participant and as a researcher, if you could maybe give us maybe like a slightly in-depth version of it.
Yeah, like a potted history. I did a really long thing for Smithsonian, so if people want to read more, they can read more. But it starts when fascism starts, right? Like, more or less, you have these groups in Italy who are called the Arditi del Popolo. I don't speak Italian very well, but they are, like, if you look at their symbol, it's a fasces, you'll see it on courthouses in the US, right?
Bundle of sticks with an axe, yeah.
And there's another axe chopping it in half. It really begins there, but it's not called anti-fascism until you have like Nazi Germany, right? And those guys actually start out as the Red Front fighters. And Nazi Germany's interesting because you have this, like, you call it the three-way fight, right? Mm-hmm. So you have the Iron Front, who are social democrats, and that's the three arrows that you see, right?
Yeah, which is, if I'm not mistaken, anti-fascism, anti-communism, and anti-something else?
Anti-monarchism.
And monarchism, yeah. So the three arrows, sadly, are anti-communist for all the communists out there.
Yeah, and it's funny to see it reappear. And I think, like, things can change. Symbols
of course,
can change
their
meaning, right? But it is always funny to see people doing that and then simultaneously dropping, like, having the same patch on their leather vest, right? They've got a hammer and sickle as well.
Yeah, the Rosa Luxemburg would disagree with you on that one.
Yeah.
From beyond the grave.
So, like, you had these fighting groups, right? And, of course, as always happens, the middle of the road kind of left-leaning people and the left-leaning people end up fighting each other, which benefits the Nazis, right?
Or
the people but in Germany, so Antifa is a rebranding of the Red Front fighters, and the Red Front fighters are, I won't say this shit in German because I don't speak German. I think you do.
I do.
Frontkampfverbund, I think.
Well, Frontkampfverbund. Yeah, that makes sense. Yeah, or either Kampfverbund or Kämpferbund. Yeah, I'm not sure.
But yeah, so these guys are, like, they're called the Red Front, right? And they later become Antifa as the broader, like, international is developing this policy called the Popular Front policy, mm-hmm, which is kind of specifically what I work with. And the idea of the Popular Front is that we can actually join together with the liberals and the social democrats and like, even maybe anti-fascist conservatives, potentially anarchists, although, like, tankies have been killing anarchists throughout the Popular Front, right? When that happens, they rebrand as Antifa, right? And interestingly, though, the Red Front also patented the raised fist for use in their symbols. It's very German.
Yeah,
1926. That's when you see this two-flag logo, right? Sometimes the black's on the front, sometimes the red's on the front. But that's the Antifa logo that is, like, everyone's Twitter profile picture now.
Sure, yeah. So the black and the red are, it's anarchists and communists, isn't it?
Yeah.
Or anarchists and socialists, I suppose.
Yeah, it's because there wasn't a huge anarchist tendency in Germany at the time.
Gotcha.
But that's also my understanding of it. And certainly, like, that's what it means now, right? And things aren't, like, determined by the historical meaning. And so it goes from there to, in my opinion, like, the biggest real, like, I'm somewhat biased because I'm a historian of Spain, representation of anti-fascism as, like, a fighting thing is in Spain. So what I work with specifically is this Popular Olympics, which we can talk about later. It's an anti-fascist alternative to the Nazi Olympics that happened in Berlin in 1936, right? It happened 85 years ago this month. And that was, like, an attempt to rebrand anti-fascism as not, like, a thing that old pipe-smoking socialists talked about,
yeah,
but as a thing that, like, young, athletic, healthy people did, right? And, like, sport, George Orwell called sport war without the shooting, right? So that's the goal of these things, is to be like, no, like, we will fuck you up, right? Like, if you come for us, we'll come for you. And it was very much, for the time, very sort of progressive in its integration of race and gender. And obviously those people, the Popular Olympics never happened, and we can talk about that. But those people go on, that same spirit goes on to become the international brigades, right? Especially at the start, when they were like the People's Anti-Fascist Militia, and they were not communist run or like run by the Comintern. They were volunteers. Most of them came through communist parties, right? But some of them didn't. Lots of them were anarchists, right? Lots of people who joined international volunteers in Spain didn't fight in the international brigades. And like, I think it's really important at this point to like, what you have in Spain, right, is you have like black officers commanding white men. You have early on in the war, you have women fighting alongside men. You have LGBTQ folks commanding straight folks, right? Like, that, like, to be anti-fascist, you have to be against hate and intolerance. And so, because what happens in Spain is that these people lose, right? The good guys lose the civil war, right? And we lose a lot of what they learn too, right? Lots of them come back to the US and the UK actually and are imprisoned.
Yeah.
Even though they're the only fucking people who know how to fight Nazis because they've been fighting the Nazi. A lot of this is like, I'm assuming background, right? But so Franco and Hitler were allies. So Franco and Mussolini. Hitler helps Franco. Mussolini sends a lot of ground troops, right? And they start doing their sort of combined arms warfare and their blitzkrieg shit. And so these guys had experience with that, with modern weapons. The rest of the military was still stuck in like World War I brain.
Yeah.
So when these guys come back, they know how to do it. But because they're black and leftist or leftist, certainly in the US, it will be impossible for them to talk to officers at, you know, West Point or whatever.
It's funny because there's a story that's fascinated me for years, and it's something that I'm hoping to write about in the future. I don't know if you're familiar with the Papuan campaign the US Army fought in New Guinea in 1942, 1943. It was one of the worst of World War II, and that's why they don't talk about it very much. You have divisions at 90%+ casualties, mostly from malaria, but also from getting chewed up in the jungles by, you know, every non-Swamp Avenue approach was, you know, a bunker made of oil drums filled with sand and palm trees cut down into logs. The turning point of that battle was the capture of a road junction at Bunagona. That was a capture of a road junction by a guy named Herman Botcher. He was promoted the battlefield promotion from or battlefield commission from staff sergeant to captain. Never fucking happens. It's insane. Take a guy who's a squad leader, make him a company commander. He was that effective. He was a premature anti-fascist, as they call him.
Yeah.
The German communist fled Germany after Hitler came to power, moved with his relatives in America, then in Australia, then joined the international brigades, fought in Spain, came back to America, was denied a commission because he was a communist, enlisted as a private, and deployed to the South Pacific. He died in 1944 in the Philippines. I think he was a major, but I think he won the Distinguished Service Cross, or if not that, the Silver Star. Completely forgotten. Like, there's so little about him that like what you can find is a few recollections from his former soldiers and like a citation and a lot of files that were so damaged by bad archival practice that like you can't even read the scans. It's unbelievable. But this guy was like a legit, as close as you can get to like the sort of apotheosis war hero, and completely forgotten. And primarily, in my opinion, because guys like that, their combat experience wasn't valued because of the politics behind it.
Yeah.
Which then, always weirds me out when people post photos of D-Day and be like, oh, anti-fascism in action. It's like, oh, really? Really, guys? Got some news for you about that.
Yeah, right. Like, look at the boats on D-Day, right? You're not going to see any black people there.
No.
Right? But if you look at the international brigade, so points you'll see like Oliver Law commanding the Abraham Lincoln Battalion, right? Which, yeah, like the Yas Nancy Pelosi crowd want to say that their grandfather was an anti-fascist, but he probably wasn't.
Yeah, and he probably went back to his hometown and became a racist cop. Like, I hate saying it. Like, I don't want to denigrate World War II veterans, but like, we don't do ourselves any favors by looking at that stuff and saying, okay, this was this platonic ideal and we've fallen from it. It's like, these guys were also human, and like, the army was segregated for a reason because America was segregated.
Like, yeah, they're not fighting for like freedom and liberty for everyone. They're fighting for, yeah, like, you can't drink at the water fountain, I can drink at.
Yeah, it's like America's material interests were threatened, but at the time, America had a more restrictive race policy than South Africa did. Like, and it was, America was the model for Nazi segregation. Like, they were not shy about saying that, like, they modeled a lot of their policies in terms of, like, marginalizing every aspect of Jewish people and other sort of the undesirables, you know, in scare quotes, civic lives, based on the way that Jim Crow was enforced. Like,
yeah.
They weren't shy about that.
No, and it's a good model of it. Like, we still like continue to persuade ourselves that like it's not a country built on stolen land, right? And it's somehow controversial to acknowledge that. And like, there were anti-fascists in the Second World War. One thing that people like, another thing that we don't write about enough, right? They're called La Nueve, but they were Spanish Republicans who fled the Republic like at the end of the Civil War, joined the French Foreign Legion, and they were the first unit into Paris.
Wow.
Okay. So like the people who liberated Paris, they were anti-fascists, right? They put their Republican flags on their tanks and like killed Nazis for 5 more years after having killed them for 4 years before. But yeah, I think that that misunderstanding is kind of crucial because it's an undertaking, right? Like it's not maybe an ideology, but it certainly is an outlook.
Yeah.
And like you don't just get to claim it by sort of because it became a massive thing in the United States last year, right? Like if you only went to the rallies where 10,000 other people came and you like drew like sidewalk chalk and then like maybe you're not actually an anti-fascist, right? Like if you left when the cops started shooting kids or when the chud started like beating people up, then like, I mean, look, if you're physically, like if that's, it's not suitable for you, whatever, that's fully understandable. But like, I think a lot of people only want to do the sort of pay lip service to the concept, sure. Right? And the whole point of Antifa in Germany, like Ernst Thälmann, right? Ernst Thälmann is a leader of the KPD, so the German Communist Antifa. He spent 11 years in solitary confinement before being shot at the end of the Second World War, right? Like that sort of like, thousands of American people, thousands of international people died in Spain, right? Like, it's not just like being like, oh, fascism bad, grandpa good.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a kind of material commitment involved, and there's also like a physical commitment involved. And I agree with you that it's not for everyone, and a lot of people can't do it. But I think that, to me, it's not that like, okay, if you don't get your skull cracked, you don't count. It's more that like, you have to understand that, like, in order to combat this stuff where it happens, you are going to have to, you know, there are people who are going to seem unsavory to you. There are going to be people who are going to seem impolite to you and people who are going to seem, you know, not refined, not polite, not considerate. But like, they're out there risking their lives when the cops take the side of the Proud Boys or Identity Europa or fucking whomever the fash group du jour is. And like, I don't think people realize this unless they've been at demos, but like, not only do the cops not protect people, the cops actively abet these guys. They help them out. They funnel protesters towards them so they can be overwhelmed. They give them water. They sometimes let them like either use their radios or relay messages to them. Like they absolutely, they'll arrest you for not putting your gum in the trash bin, but they'll let these guys beat the fuck out of someone and look the other way. Like the cops are on their side, especially American cops in northern cities run by Democratic mayors. Like the cops are an occupying army. Like they're awful. So like there's this unwillingness to break. Like if you support it, but you go to the, you know, the mandated protests where everything is within bounds, and then you're like, ah, oh, why are these people so misbehaving? It's like, because those guys are out, the frog avatar guys are out, smashing shit, trying to target non-white people, like trying to fucking harass people, trying to have white power rallies. Like, you can't really look at the people who are willing to put their bodies on the line and confront them, and confront the cops, because the cops obviously are on the side of these dudes, and be like, you didn't do your homework. You know what I mean? Like, it just seems, it's like, I hate to use this discourse, but it feels like a position of incredible privilege to look at that and be like, well, you're not doing it the way that I like. So actually, I'm just going to sit on the side and take my toys and leave. And it's like, I realize that's the story of liberalism from time immemorial, but like, I hope people can see through how hollow that is.
Yeah, I think you're right. And maybe I've said that wrong. Like, it's not, you don't count if you didn't go out there and get bashed, but like...
Yeah, I wasn't implying you were saying that, but I always sometimes think about like the worst possible interpretation. And I'm like, yeah, I do want to mitigate that perhaps.
Yeah, it's good to get that out. I think, yeah, this commitment to like bourgeois civility as a way of securing change is just bullshit, right? Like human change, sadly, or at least certainly in the United States, right? Like has always had to involve fighting the cops.
Yes.
Like you didn't get the civil rights movement without people fighting the cops. You didn't get any progress. Like Stonewall's a riot, right? Like these things, and that, like, you can't disavow that. And you can't turn your nose up at someone, right? Because they look different from you, because their nose has been broken 5 times punching Nazis. Like that's part of how we move forward. And also, like, the whole point to me of anti-fascism is treating everyone with dignity and respect, unless they would deny that to others. Right.
Yeah.
So if someone's out there with you, like I went to Oxford, I have a PhD, like my background is different to that of other people. But like, yeah, if you're that last year, I got maced in the face, right? I couldn't see and I was fucking just like very upset. And like some of the people who protected me from getting maced again or punched or shot with rubber bullets are like, yeah, they're not people who like would fit with your model of bourgeois civility, but they're some of the best people I know, right? Like those are the people who were prepared to put their bodies on the line to help a stranger. And like, that's something that's really valuable that I think is like, that's the core of anti-fascism, right? Like, I don't know you, but you deserve dignity and respect unless you're going to deny that to other people.
Yeah.
And so I'm prepared to risk my well-being to help you. And that should be a laudable thing. Apparently it's fucking controversial now.
It's wild to me. I mean, I think about this sometimes too. It's not difficult anytime in this country, for example, anytime there's an advert on social media, for example, or there's an appeal for refugee aid or anything along those lines, to go down and look at some social media comments and see just like the most repugnant fucking potato face people howling about like shoot them in the channel and stuff. I got in a bike wreck a couple of years ago. My lock slipped, hit my wheel, threw me off my bike. There was oncoming traffic. It wasn't that close, but literally within 10 seconds of me hitting the ground, four dudes came out of nowhere to help me. And like, it's South London. These guys were like Deliveroo drivers. These guys were like kids in hoodies. But you know what? Like, they were like, this guy needs help. We're going to help him. Like, and that's not the same thing as being at a demo. But the point I'm making that is that to me, like, if you have your eyes open, you'll see that like, this is not, these differences that are being foisted on you are not real. Like, this is bullshit. And a lot of like, for lack of a better word, horrible groupthink being passed around saying like that these differences are so massive. They're not massive. They're not at all.
Yeah.
Like, and the thing that kills me about it is that I feel the same way that, you know, people will look at this and be like, wow, I remember this at Occupy. I remember this at some of the protests against like the, what's it called? The WTO, the Battle of Seattle. I remember this, you know, happening at Ferguson. I remember this happening at some of the anti-austerity protests here, the student protests, hearing about this stuff. It always comes back to the sort of like, well, these people have facial piercings and they use dirty words and their signs are rude. And it's just like, yeah, but if you have a polite protest full of people with twee jokes, you get the wooferendum. A lot of fucking good that did.
Yeah, exactly. Right. Like that, like, that wild, like, don't make too much of a fuss. Don't make too much. I thought it was just a British thing. Like, I remember I went to Gleneagles and yeah, like, I remember what was really cool about Gleneagles specifically, I think, was like watching Scottish grandmothers get charged by like angry horse cops and then just lose their shit and start throwing things at them.
Yeah.
And like, that's been cool last year as well for people to, I think, realize that like, they don't care if you're nice or not. They still fucking hate you. And like, yeah, they're like, this person has facial piercings. This person will go down for you even if they don't know you. So maybe like, you should show some solidarity with them like they're going to do to you rather than, yeah, asking them to look nicely or have a sign that doesn't swear.
And it's just like the cops, the reason the cops are doing the thin blue line shit on the Union Jack the way American cops do is because they think you're fucking animals. They don't think you're the same as them. They think they are the stopcock holding back the hordes. Like, so don't romanticize it. You know what I mean? Like the cops are pretty clear about what they think, you know, especially if you get them talking on like a social media thing where they think other people aren't looking, you know. Now, obviously perhaps more so in America, but still here too. Like, They're not shy about it. And that's the thing, is that like, I feel as though for as much as people involved in Antifa get called extremists or idealists or all these things, like, I think the most extreme idealism is believing in this sort of liberal settlement in which like everyone's just trying to do their best and behave well. It's like, that implies to me that like you have never existed in the outside world.
Yeah, right. Just like, this idealism thing really bugs me actually, because like, first of all, solidarity shouldn't be like an extremist concept, right? It should be how we operate. And it is how societies operate, like outside of centuries of brainwashing by like liberalism and the state. And like, yeah, if you think I'm idealistic and yet you think that the state is benevolent and that it's going to help you when it never has, yeah, without like, unless you make it dangerous to the state to not change, the state does not change, right? Like, and you can look, there are a million, yeah, the wooferendum or whatever it is, right? Like all these sort of examples of people trying to achieve change nicely. They've never really worked. And like, yeah, it's wild to me to be like, oh, it used to be you're young and idealistic. And now it's like,
you're middle-aged idealistic.
Yeah, yeah.
It's the wildest thing.
What happened there? I didn't change and neither did the world.
I genuinely think that there's this problem, which is that, I mean, like, and I'm not trying to be disrespectful. It's just a perception of mine. That some of the most ardent opponents to the concept, but A, of like addressing what the enemy is, and then also like understanding the concept of solidarity and the fact that like polite behavior won't get you anything, are people who came of age politically at the end of the Cold War. Like, there was something about the sort of Berlin Wall coming down that people have been like, oh yes, you know, liberal democracy is always transparent. It's always fair. It's never corrupt. It's less corrupt than everything else. It's the only system going. There's no alternative, et cetera. And like, it feels as though that generation, perhaps even more so than the boomers, succumbed to this idea of sort of throwing out the baby with the bathwater, that like, basically because the Soviet Union collapsed, that means that any representation, any form of left politics whatsoever, anything that's not like the fucking European Union, does it is doomed to failure, and it's student politics, and it shouldn't be taken seriously, and blah blah blah. I'm mixing up the American catchphrases and the British catchphrases because I've lived in this country this long, but like, you hear it all the time, and it's just, it is shocking to me how the people that you will find, in my opinion at least, who are like the most clear-eyed about this are like people, younger people who are involved, especially people who are from working class backgrounds, and old people who've been like, yeah, fuck this shit. I've yeah. been mad about this since the 60s. You know what I mean? Like,
yeah, I do love the, like a big thing for me. And but that discourse you're talking about, like Francis Fukuyama, right?
Yeah,
that,
yeah,
like,
yeah.
That was like a legit academic perspective. It's just fucking, yeah, yeah. Wall comes down. And like yeah. people stop thinking.
I've heard people say you should actually read the book because the book it's like the title of The Ugly American. Like, it actually isn't representative of what you think it's representative
yeah,
of.
Yeah, it's
but that it is absolutely of its time. But that he also represents the idea that in the book it's basically like, yeah, this is a utopian idea that can't be true. So I do need to read it. But I do think that like in the same vein as like The Ugly American being used as like, oh, you don't want to be the ugly American abroad. It's like, actually, if you read the book is racist trash. But in the book, the ugly American is a person who gets along with people and isn't like in this like diplomatic enclave avoiding the natives kind of shit. You want to be the ugly American. And apparently yeah. also the end of history, like apparently the book actually isn't as bad. But I do think that notion
yeah.
of like, oh yeah, it's all, you
I
know,
think you're right. I think it does. It's been yeah. 20 years.
I have not ever read it. Yet. So like, confessing my ignorance here,
yeah.
I'm repeating different summaries I've heard, but yeah, like
yeah,
I do think that idealism, though, and you can even see if you go back and you look at like adverts from like the 1990s, how much that was just that feeling of sort of like, yep, history's over, it's all solved.
Yeah, I remember the big thing for me, like as a sports historian, is the Rugby World Cup in South Africa, right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Like we fixed it all now, right? No communism, no racism. Let's all just like rake in the money.
Yep,
and like. I remember watching that Rugby World Cup and like, it was cool, you know, like it was good. Like, oh, look, apartheid was shit and not having apartheid is better than having apartheid. But there's this Telegraph article that I always sent my students about like how Nelson Mandela won the Rugby World Cup. And then like, you can just Google South Africa and click the news tab and like, tell me like, and it, or like speak to any white South African person you run into in any conflict zone anywhere in the world and tell me if Nelson Mandela won the Rugby World Cup, right? Or Google Dyke Advisory Group and tell me how things are going. But
executive outcomes, yeah, that kind of a thing, yeah.
It's Dagger, the guy's machine gunning civilians in Mozambique. They won't like me. They dispute that.
Yeah, 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 yeah. No, I.
Yeah.
On one of my shows, we have a running joke about the eternal sort of, you know, archetype of the South African mercenary or Rhodesian mercenary, and it's like, yeah, it's to me at least. I look back at some of that stuff, and there was a kind of like. And it's also weird too, because the South Africa Rugby World Cup was around the same time as the Balkan conflict.
Yeah.
And you're like, here's this utopian version. It's like the Jesus Jones song right here, right now, playing on fucking repeat. Yeah. While like, there's a genocide happening in Europe and it's basically being let happen. You
right.
know?
Cause we've, yeah. Cause South Africa and rugby and yeah, yeah. Like, yeah, there was definitely that very strange sort of groupthink, which really I don't think existed in more diverse working class communities, right? Because mm-hmm. you could see that like, whatever we have now isn't working for you.
Yeah.
And that's like a fundamental thing, like that I think people fail, like we don't want everyone to have what we have because what we have is fucked, right? Certainly like in the United States, you know, like the police can kill you. I send insulin to people on the regular because they'll die without it, right? Like, and then that's just two things that I can get off the top of my head that like, it's a broken system. Well, like communism failed, but like we're failing too.
Yeah.
Just no one knocked down our big wall.
Yeah, exactly. And it's like, well, there are things about the UK that drive me nuts, but like if I get hit by a car, I don't have to worry about losing my entire life savings, you know, paying for an ambulance or paying for even with insurance or paying for a hospital bill. You know, like there are things about this country that drive me insane that make me think that like it's in denial about its current situation. But I also despair at the fact that people seem to be relatively, they are incredibly, and forgive me for dissing the British, this is a very British tendency to be undeservedly self-confident in a situation that is going way worse than you believe it is going. But the way that the NHS, both, you know, under the Tories and under Blair, basically got divvied up and fragmented and semi-privatized and like forced into like weird market competition things for no reason, like, is setting the stage for an American-style system. Like, it will not be a German-style system. It will not be a Swiss-style system. It will be like America. You will pay and you will get nothing. Like, I having grown up with that shit, I know what's coming. And like, I wish people could at least acknowledge that. You know what I mean? And it's like that same kind of like you said, we don't want to, we are not in a position to claim superiority for the system we live under, because anyone who's actually had to, you know, be on the blunt edge of it, or the maybe that's the wrong metaphor, but anyone who has to be on the receiving end of it knows what it's actually like. Yeah. And yet there is this, and there was this, you know, very, very just insanely utopian kind of like, that's all gone now, everything's great now, you know, things can only get better.
Yeah. And you see it again with Joe Biden, right? In the United States, at least. Like, that dude is shipping people to Haiti. He sent more people to Haiti from January to May than Donald Trump did in the in an entire year. Right, like shipping people un-COVID tested on massive full planes to Haiti, where they get COVID and can't get treated. Right, like it's under this program called Title 42, so he's technically not deporting them, but like he's just getting away with it because he smiles nicely and doesn't tweet. Like, but Donald Trump shit posted and did racist shit, so like it was somehow different.
I guess I'm interested in your take on this. You know, on the topic of, specifically with regard to like the view of anti-fascism, is that to me, I have not been back to America since before COVID happened.
Right.
Last time I was in America was in October 2019. You know, I've lived in the UK for 3 years, and yeah, so it's been a while since I've been in America. My impression is that there was, much like there was a huge upswing in popular support among white people for Black Lives Matter post George Floyd protests, it has now swung back to the point where it is lower than it was before that moment. Similarly, I get the impression that with the advent of Biden and the sort of conservative Democrats back in power, that there is a similar sort of like, if not disavowal, then pretending it didn't exist towards that momentum that was there before. And that did seem genuine, even if like the protests didn't necessarily materialize into like tangible policy gains. Like, there was energy there and there was radicalizing.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering what you live in the US, what your take is as far as like being involved in this stuff, seeing it. Like, I remember years ago I had an anti-war activist on, and he said that it was much harder to organize donors, events, press for anti-war things when there's a Democratic president. But as soon as Trump took office, suddenly these people were anti-war. And he's like, and as soon as Trump leaves office and if a Democrat takes over, they won't be anti-war anymore.
Yeah, I think that like the vulgarity of Trump was what people found so offensive, right? Mm-hmm. Like the appearance of incivility rather than the material change that he affected, which was very little because he was kind of useless. Oh, it was still horrible for a lot of people. But yes, I think it is. Like, I think some people were irrevocably changed by what they experienced last year, and that's cool. Like, a lot of people who came out, and it was probably this sort of coalescence of like the horrific murder of George Floyd, the pandemic, Donald Trump just shit posting fascist shit for 3 years at that point. Like, everyone was mad. But yeah, it's hard. Like, now, you just don't see the number of people, you don't see the solidarity, you don't see people giving to mutual aid anymore. And maybe it's also because the economy is tough, people don't have money and things, but it breaks you. Like, there are kids right now in our convention center in San Diego, right, unaccompanied young women. And like, why the fuck are people not livid about that? You know, like, these kids are getting COVID, they're not able to contact their parents. It's a horrible situation. And like the whole no more kids in cages thing, which everyone was all about. Like, you could get like really kind of centrist type folks. Like, I think most people found that morally objectionable, rightly. And it's still happening. And yeah, like, but Joe Biden is nice and Kamala wears Converse, so we don't get mad about it.
Yeah, it feels like the rhetoric has changed. And it feels like to me, what you're saying is that this is nothing new at all. And that like, if you talk about being anti-fascist, if you talk about the origins of this and the mentality involved, that solidarity, that generosity, but also that militancy, like these kinds of ebbs and flows are nothing new. And like, we have historical precedent for what happens when this stuff, you know, people are no, like the sort of comfortable center is no longer feeling afflicted.
Yeah, definitely. So like, if we pick up that history after World War II, right? Yeah, there is a decrease in anti-fascist sentiment, like right after the end, because the Cold War immediately begins.
Yeah,
and so we don't sort of. There's certainly like there was never the respect due to like people like the Abraham Lincoln Brigades, right? They got McCarthy'd, right? They couldn't work. Most of them died poor and unemployed. Luckily, some of them like received the solidarity of their other union members, and they were okay. But yeah, if we look at kind of where it goes, it remains in the UK actually, with because. We have the Windrush generation coming over to the UK, right? Which is like Afro-Caribbean migrants coming from Britain's colonies after the war. And that obviously provokes white people in Britain to start doing their racist shit again, because they didn't ever intend for like the people in the colonies to be their neighbors, right?
Yeah.
They wanted them to be their subordinates. And so we see, and we see it with Jewish people too, right? With Oswald Mosley and his, like, with anti-Semitism continuing in the UK. And it was always here. And it's here when we were fighting the Nazis too. We see like organized groups of Jewish World War II veterans going to fight like Oswald Mosley's fascists, right? And so it remained, and then like it, I think it really comes up again, and it, like you say, it just lulls, right? Because everyone's sort of happy with like the more, I guess, crass and vulgar and public racism of the National Front. You see a response to that. And the same in Germany, right? When you have a generation that's removed from the war years, then you have, and then you have a subsequent generation, right? And these kids didn't grow up maybe with rationing or whatever it is. I think sometimes we make too much of that. But it's in the 70s and 80s, right, that you see both in like Hamburg specifically, right, in the squads, people reclaiming. And that's when the Antifa logo comes back, right? That's when like you start to see people being like, yeah, we are squatters, we're punks, we're anti-fascist, and we're anti-racist, right? And there's essentially like kind of a cluster concept there.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of the squatter punk stuff in the 70s was sort of like a post-1968 kind of thing, that like it's an offshoot of a lot of what was happening, but kind of in the, there's both the success and a failure of that sort of new left moment, you know, in the post-war period. And, you know, here, when I think of it, I'm not British, obviously, my mom's family is, but I grew up in America. But I think about like, okay, mental association with events, what's going on? Well, you have all, like you said, all of the racist reaction to immigration from Britain's former colonies. You also have stuff like the formation of the National Front. You have stuff like, I don't know, Eric Clapton going on a rant about black people at a concert. You have the formation of Rock Against Racism and those kinds of things. You have a squatter movement. All this stuff is, to my perception, often, if not completely linked with left politics. Some of it is kind of like hippie-ish anti-politics, but some of it is extremely organized left politics too. And I got the impression that that was very true in Britain in the 70s and early 80s, in Germany. In Germany, you have a tremendous reaction against guest workers and a lot of kind of like unenforced silence, like people being like, we're fed up of having to be sorry for what happened.
Yeah,
like there's a lot of that. You have a similar reaction in France with sort of organized racist parties. You have less so on the Iberian Peninsula because fascism didn't end until the 70s.
Yeah, it's still going.
Yeah, exactly. So between Salazar in Portugal and Franco in Spain, you basically have, you have the kind of like post-left 60s sort of experience of societal liberation in the 70s and 80s because they had fascist dictatorships. But in just call it Northwest Europe, it does strike me that like you have this reemergence after the kind of like 30 post-war years where you have both society back in economic decline because of the crises of the 70s, and then you also have this like immense societal reaction both against like the politics but also against just like the physical presence of non-white people or of any minorities whatsoever.
Yeah, definitely. Like that 68 generation, right, which sort of questions the politics, but then like we have the 68 moment, right, like in Paris and everywhere else, which isn't really phrased as anti-fascist and isn't about that so much. It's like it's just about it's about the state, right? It's this Marcusean kind of great rejection. So I think that generation that comes, and they explicitly link it sometimes, right? Like Joe Strummer has the Red Army faction t-shirt that's famous.
I was thinking about that. Yeah, it could be Marcusean, it could be people calling themselves Maoists, it could be people like worshiping a crystal. Like it's a huge moment, but it's like there's not one dominant politics to it.
Yeah, and I think that was the point of 68, was right, like the like this great refusal, like just saying, no, this is fucked. Like, we'll work it out in the streets, which is fine, actually, in my opinion. But yeah, what you got in the 80s was a more organized, like, we are anarchists. Yeah. We are whatever, like left libertarian, which is a phrase that American people should use more, by the way. I had it removed from my dissertation by force, but left libertarian to encompass people who want the left but don't want the state, or at least don't want to be just like crass tankies. I think like it's something we should maybe start trying to use again, because it might bring people in, right? Like, an interesting thing that I found in rural America is that lots of people are somewhat anarchist in their way of thinking and acting, right? Like, if your neighbor needs something, you'll probably help them. You might not if they don't look like you, or if they don't sleep with the sort of people you sleep with or whatever. But for the most part, people do look out for each other. And I think that, like, there's a way to bring those people in, unless they're reprehensible fucking racists. And then...
Sure, yeah. Francis, my co-host, is from St. Louis, Missouri, and a lot of his family is from Southern Missouri. And he talks about this a lot, that, like, there's both incredible solidarity and a kind of, like, decentralized organization of communities. But then also there's, like, you know, conspiracy theory, reaction, insane racism. Like, so that's, it's not like there's this, like, you know, pastoral, like, primitive communist kingdom down in Southern Missouri. You got a lot of good and a lot of really bad.
Yeah.
And I do get that impression. I mean, when I hear about people talk about libertarian socialism here in the UK a lot as kind of like a follow on to the anti-austerity and student protests in the early 2010s. Like, I think for a lot of ways, I've heard this argument put forth, and I think I see some merits to it, that Corbynism actually kind of represented a sort of like actual egalitarian liberalism more than it represented like a massive destruction and replacement of the state. Like,
yeah.
British columnists are insane and they're going to be hyperbolic and say that he's Pol Pot, but like Corbyn actually was just like, Corbyn's politics was one of sort of like actual, in my opinion, like egalitarian liberalism. Like, we're going to make the state treat everyone equally by force. Not in like a removal of classes way, but just sort of in like a address its massive inequities way. And that got painted as something probably more left wing than it actually was, all things considered.
That tends to be the thing with like the, and maybe it's just because of the class of people, or the education of people who are in the media, but we immediately go to like Pol Pot and Stalin.
Stalin, yeah, exactly. Right? And it's like, if you looked at Jeremy Corbyn, to paraphrase David Graeber, you know, may his memory be a blessing. If you looked at paraphrasing David Graeber and said, I see Corbyn supporters and I think they're going to march me to a gulag, that says more about your own secret belief that you belong in a gulag than anything about their politics. Because like literally Corbynism, and I mean, I was out there being the fucking, you know, sort of door-to-door salesman of Corbynism for a while, was about fixing, making this country the country it could be if it wasn't bogged down in just like immense corruption, inequity, you know, class stratification and racism. Like, that was it. It was like a weird kind of like, imagine the potential of this place if we stopped just accepting that things have to be shit for some reason. And it's like, so to me, I think the strain that a lot of people talked about, like it was kind of a libertarian socialism in a way. It was kind of like an idea of, you know, the state is going to improve and it's going to stop persecuting somehow. We didn't really reconcile that. And you are going to be both cared for and left alone. And right. That was a vision that was like, maybe libertarian, to me, libertarian as an American has this very negative connotation, but I see what you mean, left libertarianism. Like, because I think what I saw here, at least in the way it was put forth, was an articulation of that. Like, you know, here we're going to create a society that takes care of everyone at every point of their life, but also lets people kind of do their own thing. And you don't, it's not like you're going to be fucking, you're not going to be corralled by the party any more than you're going to be corralled by market forces. You know what I mean?
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Like, it's the idea that we're here to help you, not to control you. Or to deter. And we use it a lot in Spain, right? Because in the Spanish Civil War, like the left is like an alphabet soup of anarchists and anarcho-syndicalists and Trotskyites and non-Stalinist communists and such. So like it does well there. But yeah, I think it's one we could do well to reclaim.
I kind of took you on a tangent there, but I guess I wanted to bring it up because to me, that's the closest that I've ever seen electoral politics really come to representing my own beliefs. And so to have it so comprehensively crushed in this like complete rat fuck, and obviously as like someone with at least some extended Jewish background, like it was very frustrating to see anti-Semitism wielded as this cudgel to basically paint, basically to now have a point where the Labour Party in its present incarnation is like, oh, are you one of the 10 million people who voted for Labour in 2019? Well, you're a Nazi. You know, like, it's disgusting, but like, I can't deny that our politics was comprehensively eviscerated. And it's very frustrating to see this because I saw this incredible solidarity. You know, we didn't have the street protests here to the same extent. We did, but like the police were super hostile and there were more anti-Black Lives Matter protests in this country than Black Lives Matter protests. You know, a lot of pissed up guys fucking protecting statues of historical nonces. Like, it was bad. It was really bad. Like, this country, the reaction to Black Lives Matter in this country was one of right-wing reaction, by and large.
Yeah.
And we didn't have it. But under Corbynism, you saw this incredible manifestation of, like, what is this sort of ecumenical leftism, and to some extent, liberalism, too. And, you know, we got told it was worse than Hitler, and then we got completely rat-fucked, and that's the end, you know? Like, it's like, we're in a way, I feel like they'll be more thorough in dismantling the left in this country than they were after Michael Foote lost in 1983. And so, like, what hope does that leave for people who actually believed in it? Like,
so many people, I think, believe in it and just don't believe that they believe in it, right? Or have been told not to believe in it, or have been told that, like, it's something other than what it is, that, like, the only choice is what we have, or Stalin, Pol Pot, and, like, I wish we could, like, I remember coming to the United States, and we can end this tangent, and I first time I've been there, I'm going to do my PhD, I went to Disneyland, but, like, I'm coming again, 21, I get off, and I've got my kefir on, I got my Free Palestine badge, and I've got my Rock Against Racism badge here, and I'm just, you know, like, living the dream, and I walk up to the CBP guy there, and he's like, oh, what are you doing in America, son? And I was like, I'm doing a PhD. And he's like, what are you studying? And I was like, political violence in anarchism. And it was straight off into the little room to take all my clothes off.
Oh, fuck's sake.
And like, what is so, yeah, like, maybe we need to change it. Right? There's this idea, and like, this is something perpetrated by my colleagues in the media, that anarchism is a predilection for chaos and violence. And it is the opposite of that, right? It's just wanting to be left alone and look after one another. And yet, like, it's constantly presented as like, yeah, the anarchists are the Black Bloc people, right? And the Black Bloc people are the ones, like, God forbid, smashing the window of a fucking Starbucks, right? Like, I've seen people walk away from BLM because someone broke the window of a Starbucks, right? And like, at the same time they are upset about that, the cops are like actively physically assaulting someone right there.
Yes.
But like, you crossed a line.
Laughing while, you know, right-wing protesters are beating someone up and doing nothing. Like, I mean, I make the joke sometimes, like, yeah, if the broken window at Starbucks annoys you that much and obsesses you that much, can I introduce you to this thing called wage theft? Because you might find that you could buy a lot of windows. I see this stuff, and I obviously, like, one of the reasons I wanted to talk to you was I wanted to, like, the clarification, you know what I mean? Like, what are the origins of this stuff? Like, what are its antecedents? What are its manifestations now? But I realized that so much of it is like, it's not even disaggregating like the different tendencies within like an organized resisting left. A lot of it is just combating just complete bullshit that's made up.
Yeah, but it was ever thus, right? Like this, if you look at the way that the Nazis were, there were conspiracy theories in the 1930s were a big thing. I think one thing that's great about this resurgence in the anti-fascist conversation is this idea of a popular front, which is really appealing to me, which is like, we can put aside some of our differences because we all agree that those people are worse.
Yeah.
Right. And we can't put aside all of them. Like, if you want to be racist and also be an anti-fascist, you can fuck right off.
And there's a lot of people that kind of want to do that. Yeah. So I know what you mean.
Yeah. Or transphobic, right? Like, yeah. You can't be.
Like, every fucking communist party in this country is apparently insanely transphobic. I don't know why.
And I don't get it. Like, I don't get it at all. You treat people with dignity and respect, and it's got nothing to do with you, any other part of their gender identity. And like, yeah, furthermore, those people are allies. And you should be allies with them. And if you're not, you're not a leftist.
I wouldn't have the shows that I have, and we wouldn't have the success we have if we didn't have trans fans. Like, they are some of the most supportive people, you know, that are really down for the idea of like, well, these guys are army veterans, but like, they actually want to oppose militarism and keep people from joining the military. You know what I mean? Like, I don't get a lot of support for fucking gun fuckers from this. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. I get, and so it's wild to me that people want to like delineate this. Like, you'll see people who would otherwise have politics that are in alignment with yours, but that one like 3% fucking difference there, where they're like, actually, gender identity is a bourgeois affectation or some shit. You're like, no, what the fuck are you talking about?
Yeah, that's the whole like sort of online tanky is another thing that like we could get into. But yeah, specifically the transphobia on the left, it just needs to stop. Like, we can't tolerate that shit. Yeah. And we can. Like, I guess we can take the time to talk to someone once and be like, why are you doing this? It doesn't line up with what you profess to believe, and then after that you can fuck off if you still want to do it, right? But yeah, that what I like about anti-fascism and our conversation around that is that we can be like, you can be a libertarian socialist, I can be an anarcho-syndicalist, someone else can be a Trotskyite, right? And like, we can all put aside our differences. And I think it's based in like, what I love about like reading the International Brigade's memoirs, right, is that they're fundamentally just working people who have looked across the world and been like, that guy's basically the same as me. Doesn't matter if he doesn't speak Spanish, doesn't matter if he's gay or straight, black or white, right? Like, he is put upon, and these people want to make it worse. And unless we stop this now, then it's coming here.
Yeah.
And like, if we could just get back to that, right? Like, solidarity is not complicated. It doesn't require spending the 10 years I spent in academia to work out what anti-fascism is. It's seeing someone treading on someone and seeing yourself there and saying like, that could be me. Or like, there, but for the grace of God, go I, right? Or like, a thing that John McCain, of all fucking people, John, the last American veteran of the Abraham Lincoln Brigades, died relatively recently. And John McCain wrote his op-ed, which is a fucking problem, or his op-ed, right? Like, do better, New York Times, as always. Like, yeah, come on, pick someone who wasn't opposed to everything he stood for, right? But McCain had this thing about For Whom the Bell Tolls. And that's because McCain only engaged with the Spanish Civil War through Ernest Hemingway, right?
Sure, yeah.
To be another slightly sexist white man, or very sexist white man.
And ultimately, like, McCain, people of McCain's generation had two ways of dealing with it. I think it was, like you said, either the romanticism via Ernest Hemingway, or just like full-on McCarthyism.
Yeah. That's where they went to be communists. But like, that thing about like, it's John Doe, the poem, isn't it? Like, ask not for whom the bell tolls.
Yep.
Right? Like, that is what it's about, really. Like, you don't say like, oh, that's them, right? Like, it's you, right? The person with the boot on their throat could be you, and therefore it is you, and therefore it's on you to fight it, right? It's not someone else's responsibility.
Yeah.
And like, that is the crux of what we see. Like, we see that still, right? People going to Rojava, like that, and look, not everything is wonderful and perfect, and it wasn't in Spain either, right? But the basic element of like, I'll, or the people who helped you when you crashed your bike, like, so I'll step in the road and try and help you, right? Like, that is not complicated, and it should be, like, all of us should feel that way. Anyway, we should be able to put aside that, like, I understand that physical violence is not for everyone, but physical violence is necessary sometimes, and it's part of it. And like, Black Bloc, right? I get that Black Bloc looks scary, largely because you've been conditioned, I think, to make it look scary and by media representations of Black Bloc. But like, Black Bloc comes around in the 80s, right, in Germany, same time as this resurgence of Antifa, right? And we did Black Bloc, we did White Bloc too. British people will be familiar with the Wombles, who got infiltrated by a cop, by the way, who worked out that everyone was just nice and wanted to look after other people. And like, when these guys got arrested, he testified in their defense because he was like, I've done a fucking terrible thing. You're all just nice people. But we do that because like, it's a bit like Zapatismo, right? Like, you see people wearing balaclavas. People, you can Google it if you're not familiar. But like, the idea is not to speak for yourself, but to speak for everyone and be part of everyone, right? It's also not to be individually isolated and persecuted by the state, but when you've acted on behalf of other people. But it makes you a block, right? That's the point. It's to say, like, we are them, they are us, they're treading on you, then, like, I'll come and be treaded on too, you know? And that shouldn't be complicated. It shouldn't be controversial at all. And like, yeah, if a few Starbucks get fucked up, I don't care. Like, and if you want to claim your grandfather an anti-fascist, look at what they did to Dresden and like, get back to Starbucks. Yeah,
and also, I guess the thing for me is that like, if your commitment to left politics or to anti-fascism or even just like to an anti-racist struggle is so paper thin that one act of something that you see as like unnecessary is enough to sway you from it entirely, then like, it strikes me that this is similar to the people who are always like, oh, I used to be a leftist, but, or I used to be a Marxist, but. It's like, yes, exactly. Like, you all, apparently you were all, you know, diehard absolute Marxist-Leninists for about 10 minutes to say you could, and then now you're a right-winger.
Yeah.
Like, and that just, I mean, like, I don't know. I look at some of this stuff and I think people want to act as though a social movement or any kind of large action can happen and it'll be flawless and spotless and there will not be any transgression or any missteps, and that's not the case. And secondly, like, I guess the point that I would make is that, you know, if you as someone who is turned off by this think, well, actually I want to take the moral high ground, like, the fact is there are a lot of people who have decided to take sides and become proponents of that side, sometimes physically, And unfortunately, my experiences in America, if you are white, most of those people are on the right wing side. Most people that look like you are on the right wing side. Like, that's not everyone, obviously, but like, it's certainly the case where I'm from in the Midwest. And I bring this up not as a non sequitur, but more like to say, I feel as though we are heading towards a moment in which, like, you're going to have to pick a side and be prepared that even if you don't, even if you were perfectly well behaved, it doesn't mean anything to the people that want to crush this, you know, that want to oppress you. That doesn't mean anything. The fact that your cell phone traveled in your pocket to a state-sanctioned protest for Black Lives Matter is enough to condemn you to death in the opinion of some of these people.
And those people don't care. I think also, like, the idea that it's a moral high ground to condemn violence on both sides, it's what you're doing is turning your back on the people against whom the state are doing violence, right? And the state is, like, we should always remember, like, the state is a monopoly on legitimate violence, right? That the state exists because whatever it is, right? If it's a parking fine, if it's not drinking at a certain age, if it's speeding, what that comes down to is the fact that, like, if you break that law, right, then you'll get a fine and you don't pay the fine. And they'll tell you to go to court and you don't go to court. Then some dudes with guns will come and fucking kill you or arrest you, right? Like, that is what the state is. That's the language it speaks, right? Like Jean-Paul Sartre's Introduction to the Wretched of the Earth. It's a very, like, 1968 book, right?
Yeah.
Where he talks about violence, right? It's called On Violence. And he speaks about how, like, the colonized person experiences the state. The language of the state is one of rights and equality, right? It says, oh, you are French, we are French, you're just Algerian. But it's okay because we're all brothers. And then that's what the state says. But what the state does is it speaks through violence, right? So the real communication isn't happening through words. It's happening through violence. So when that person wants to speak back, they understand that shit gets done through violence. And it doesn't matter, right, what people say, because what they've been saying is you're my equal and what they've been doing is killing you. So when you speak back, you're not going to be like, hey, actually, I'm your equal. Could we please be nice to me? You're going to fight back because you've been being fought against.
Yeah.
Right.
I think about this sometimes in this country with some of the discourse that takes place. And obviously, like, there's a lot of class gatekeeping in that, but it's sort of like looking at the American equivalent of saying, okay, well, I condemn the violence on both sides when the cops are actively abetting stuff like Proud Boys and other white nationalist groups. It's like being in Britain and being like, well, I would believe these people who talk about being, you know, persecuted by the DWP and literally forced into starvation and homelessness, but they're kind of rude. And I saw this really nice advert on the TV about the DWP. So I think actually both sides are bad. Like, it makes no sense. Like, if you know anything about the situation, you understand that, like, for American listeners, over the course of the last 11 years, you know, the British state has contracted massively because incredible basically monetarist ideologues and austerity ideologues have run the country and have basically used the global financial crisis as an excuse to cut every aspect of the British state, primarily the social safety net. And so lots and lots of people who were classified as disabled in previous decades were basically reevaluated and told, even when they literally, like, were quadriplegic, that they were healthy to work, fit to work. And there are many, the estimates from international observers is that something along the lines of 100 to 120,000 people have died as a result of this. People who can't afford food, people starving to death, people dying because they can't get medicine, people committing suicide, like deaths of despair, all these things. And it was done basically through a system that almost, I want to say, it's something like between 60 and 80% of people's personal independence payments, which is like the equivalent of a disability SSD in America, when they are denied it or it is removed, those cases are won on appeal in a massive number, like over 60%, maybe closer to 80%. However, most people don't realize that they can appeal or have the money to appeal. And the system, much like immigration decisions, the same exact figures are involved. The state does this because even though it's absolutely breaking the law and it would lose on appeal, it banks on the fact that these people cannot fight back against it. And so I use that analogy because anyone who's experiencing that knows the brutality of the British state. But a lot of people will be like, well, those people are just work shy. I don't trust them. You know, when these are people who oftentimes, you know, became disabled later in life, and they have given the best years of their life paying taxes, working in this state. And that's not even the qualifier, but in these situations, these people have, and they are being treated this way because the state can, because they want lower tax rates and private jets for them and no social safety net for people who aren't them.
Yeah.
And it's like, to me, I'm not saying that that's analogous, or rather, I'm not saying it's identical, But I think there's some analogy to be made there about like the violence of the state, the force of the state, how it feels to receive it versus how it feels to feel as though you are represented by the class of people enforcing it.
Yes. Yeah, yeah, exactly. I get exactly. Yeah, it is violence even if you don't see it. If it's not someone choking a man to death, right? If you're leaving someone to die hungry. Or like, I've worked a lot in nonprofit and refugee situations. Yeah. And like,
I can only imagine, yeah.
Yeah, like I've watched people die feet from the United States, right? Like I've literally feet, like the wall is right there, right there. They were like, I've watched people die of preventable, treatable conditions, right? And like, that's violence too, right? Like we chose to let that person die. Your taxes paid for the people who fired tear gas over the fence at women and children, yeah. Right? Like that, and you're responsible for that shit. If you don't speak out about it, you're literally paying for it if you're a taxpayer. And yeah, like that sort of idea that that's not as violent as, you know, not just some, like, let's say like someone threw a firework at the cops or whatever, like the most, like the peak of anti-fascist violence last year, right? Or like, it was a year since the guy blindsided the cop. I don't know if you saw that. The cop had a guy on the ground, was kind of kicking him, and some dude just comes in like at full speed.
Yeah. I saw that.
Like
yeah.
That guy, right? Like that was about as bad as it really got, right? Like other than that, it was mostly defensive violence, right? It was people with shield walls. But like, yeah, if you're going to compare that to like the stuff that I have seen and the stuff that like you could see if not all the other people were unwilling to go into some of those situations, or some of the other people were not.
I'm going to think about people here in this country who were brain damaged during the student protests, like cops hitting them with those retractable sticks. And like one guy was like literally will never walk again. Like he was so severely brain damaged from. And that's just your... you know, British cop, Met cop on the beat.
Yeah, he doesn't even have like a 6-barrel, 40-millimeter launcher
to fire at you. Yeah.
But yeah, like that's, yeah, the state is violence and you can't wash your hands of that. And so like, you got to make a choice and it sucks, but you know, yeah, that's where we are. And yeah, what I really love about writing about the 1930s is this idea, like, especially maybe, okay, if I talk about the Popular Olympics a little bit. That's my thing. I'm just going to go off now.
Let's do it.
But okay. So like what I really love about that, right, is like, if you remember, I spoke about like these young people who came to like, they were much maybe like the people at the start of like last summer, right? Like ideologically committed to this idea of equality and decency, yeah. Right? And they didn't want to go to Berlin. You see like a mixed race or biracial boxer from Pittsburgh, right? And he didn't go to the Olympic trials, right? And for a young biracial man in America, that is a good, like Jesse Owens was you know, he's Jesse Owens.
Yeah, yeah.
So that was a big opportunity. Didn't want to go because the Nazis were racist. And what was really cool actually was the NAACP and the boycott campaign before the 1936 Olympics. As much as it campaigned because the Nazis very obviously didn't like black people, it also campaigned because they wanted to stand in solidarity with the persecution of Jewish people, right? They saw the boot on someone else's neck and they realized that it was the
yeah.
same. And you can read people like, there's a guy called Edward Luttrell McDaniels. They called him El Fantastico because he could throw grenades ambidextrously. He was a black guy in the International Brigade, the Abraham Lincoln Battalion. I always get those two mixed up.
Yeah.
And then someone will be in the comments.
yeah, famously people are not pedantic about this stuff.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. And so I think those and guns, people are very chill on. So like... he is like, I've seen my people's enemy and I know that it's here, right? So these people who turn up in Barcelona, right? They know that fascism is bad, right? These guys who come from the United States, one of them, another one, Al Chaykin, like he's older. He was in his 30s. He's not that old. But he had been a very good wrestler. He had just missed out on Olympic selection and he'd retired from active competition to teach at the City University in New York, right? His parents had fled pogroms in Russia, actually. So he'd come from Russia. A Jewish person because of the violence, sees what's happening in Spain, is like, yeah, maybe I'll just do a little bit more wrestling so I can go there and be part of this spectacle, right? So you have these people, these various people who've turned up for various reasons, and you totally have people like some of the Canadian guys I know were just like, I'm not going to make it on the Olympic team and this sounds fun. So they turn up, they're in Barcelona, they're getting ready for their first night of competition, and what happens is the Spanish Civil War starts, right? So the Spanish Civil War begins the day the Popular Olympics are supposed to begin. There are soldiers marching in the streets trying to do a coup. And for these people, they have to make all those decisions that we've been talking about right then, right? Like, what are you going to do? You're going to stay in your hotel and renounce the violence on both sides? Are you going to go out, grab a shovel, and start building barricades? And that's what they do. The vast bulk, or like a large number of them, I should say, get out and help, right? They don't speak the same language. if you read the American's diaries, I'm doing a book based on like these, this one day, right? But if you read the American diaries, they're shocked. They're like, oh, these women, these Catalan women are like, they're building the barricades and they're leading these squads and they're fighting against the Nazis. Like they're just like, they're fighting as the equals of the men, right? And for a number of them, about 200 to 400, they stay, right? Like they came just like people at the Olympics now. They're going to stay for 2 weeks, do their sport thing and come home. And lots of them are really high level athletes. Often if you look, the workers' sport athletes are doing better times, higher jumps, throwing things further than the athletes who went to the Olympic Games. Because the Olympic Games enforce this idea of amateurism. And amateurism means you have to be rich enough to do this shit in your free time.
Yeah.
You have to be good enough to do it all the time. So your free time has to be all your time. So these people are, you know, they really are there for the sport and to show solidarity. But the fact that some of them were like, okay, well, I don't speak their language, but these people are being trodden on. And if we don't stop this now, then we're next. So I'm just going to stay. And they all die, right? Like every single one of them dies in Madrid, in the Battle of Madrid, where like, and then Madrid was like sort of some of the first kind of urban fighting like we would see in World War II. They fought in the faculties of the university and they would pile up the books from the library to make barricades. And they'd worked out how many books you needed to stop whatever bullets they would have, Mausers. And so like for these people, I think that's really inspiring for me, for them to have that like gut reaction solidarity, to be like, yeah, you're like me and so I'll help you. Yeah, and even though you don't share a language, you're really very little else. And the fact that in the end, like 45,000 people came with the international brigades, to me is really special. Like, and that's what we should think about when we think about anti-fascism, like those people. And not all of them were like, in fact, if you look at their record in combat, like they weren't very well trained. Some of them did very well. They were very, very committed, but they certainly weren't the sort of people who wanted, like, they weren't like, fuck yeah, a chance to shoot people.
That sure,
wasn't what they were about.
Seems like it was more sort of like, well, I'm here, I'm going to lend whatever I can to this, you know?
Yeah, and what they needed, because the entire army, so Spanish Civil War starts with a coup, right? So the army turns on the people. Some of the police support them, but some don't. The only places the coup fails are the places where the government allows the working people to arm themselves, where it doesn't allow them to arm themselves, the coup succeeds, right? So it's these people just being like, well, it's this, or fascism, right? And I could run away, but then there'll be another country. And then like, either we're next or France is next or Britain is next and it'll come for us eventually. So I'm going to stop it here. That was a slogan, right? Like, no pasarán.
Yeah.
And then Madrid will be the tomb of fascism was what they said. Wasn't, but like they really believed that enough that they were prepared to die for it, which is cool.
Yeah. Let me ask you, as someone who both knows about this period and also participates in the modern struggle, what are you feeling optimistic about? And then what are you feeling pessimistic about?
Yeah, that's a good one. I'm optimistic about the wonderful people I've met. Like the amount of people of all ages and different backgrounds who have shown like incredible solidarity and continue to show up for one another in all different aspects of their lives, right? Like those networks that people built last summer, they exist now. And like they exist... for instance, the other day I was riding my bike and I came across an unhoused lady who was having seemed to be some kind of mental break, right? And like my options are to call the cops who might hurt her, right? Or to call this group of people who are like, who last year were a bunch of strangers who turned up with bandanas over their faces and like black hoodies, right? And like they were able to organize and help that person. Like, so those structures exist to do things outside of the state. And like, that's what we should be doing, right? Building sustainable networks of support outside of the state. So I'm really excited about that. And like, I'm excited about how that continues and seeing people do mutual aid over the border. And like, whenever I need something, I'm going over the border, I can ask and I know someone will try their very best to get it, right? And then I'm dissuaded by like all the people who just went back to brunch, like the people who are like, especially after January the 6th, right? Like, people, I see it all the time, like this, like, oh, but the FBI are okay. Like, yes, FBI. Like, I could have told you what was going to happen on January the 6th. Like, if you just needed to log on to the internet, you could have seen, like, the epic fail that they, like, demonstrated there in very public view. And yeah, they managed to catch some people afterwards, largely by using OSINT tactics that anti-fascists created or sort of perfected, or just by straight up asking, right? Like, That's neither competent nor particularly like morally sort of brilliant. So like seeing this whole, like the people who were like there for the Women's March in 2017 and there for the start of BLM, but now aren't there for Joe Biden deporting Haitian people. That makes me sad, you know? Like, I really thought that solidarity meant that and that, like, we would continue to show up for one another. So, yeah, people who were, I guess, appalled by the vulgar appearance of Donald Trump's policies, but not by the inhuman consequences of them, apparently. Sure. That makes me really sad.
It does. It does. As an American, it does strike me that there is a tendency to look at Trump and Trump's more vulgar, you know, compatriots and act as though that these were generated out of thin air, that these didn't have, you know, any kind of precedent from Republican politics, right-wing politics, nativism in America, or even like pre-World War II, like just the kind of politics that America, that defined the history of the country. The idea that he was this aberration and not the logical consequence of it, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's a little weird having that kind of John Birch society, know-nothing politics, you know, put through the lens of a senile TV game show host with like the most vulgar, like outer borough New York tendencies. But like the politics are the same. And to me, people acting as though like, well, that one's done. It worries me the same way that people are like, oh, well, surely there will always be an NHS. Like,
yeah, not if they get a chance to put it away from you. Yeah. Yeah, I wish British people would, but most of my family work for the NHS. Like, you would miss it if it was gone. I'll always get things from people. I'll be like, oh, but in America, you don't have to wait. Yes, but that's because half the people don't have access.
Yeah, exactly.
And you still have to wait.
Yeah. And quite frankly, a lot of the problems with the NHS are because of A, forced privatized competition, and B, just funding cuts. Like, yeah. Or like relative terms funding cuts. I mean, the problems that I've experienced is more like, they haven't been able to update their systems or synchronize them in 25 years. I wonder why.
Yeah.
I wonder who contributed to that. You know, it's like they're still using like Windows NT on shit because like they can't afford, they won't give them the money. Like
they're broke. We were walking today through London and like it was just the most, it struck me, and I'm sure they built some of this shit before. It's most powerfully British thing, like by Marble Arch, right? You've got like, they've built a giant mound, like it's just a pile of soil. And then there's this memorial to like animals in warfare. I'm like, those are fine, right? But like, we left our elderly population to die in massive numbers last year. And now we built a giant fucking pile of dirt so you can look at London and like a giant bronze dog because like of the like national obsession World War II.
I think about, yeah, it's like we will have, they'll declare three more bank holidays relative to World War II holidays before they, or World War II events before they acknowledge the fact that the Home Office specifically set out to deport as many black British citizens as possible.
Yeah.
Like,
and then a boat will do donuts in the Thames.
And fucking honk the horn. Yeah.
Yeah.
Like, oh my God.
There'll
yeah.
be a football
I
match.
I thought I was losing my mind. I'm glad you brought that up because yes, like as an outsider, I'm like, is this normal? Like, is this how this country normally is?
It is. Yeah. It's very, yeah. Or someone in the royal family will get married. And we'll forget all that shit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. We'll be told to I don't know. I always find it funny, and we'll close it out on this because it's just one of these things. Like I think with anti-fascist national myths of the present and the past, it's a similar thing. We are always butting up against national myths and myth making, and I think so much of sort of the narrative of who won and how they won in the previous struggles, like, is always so sanitized and always kind of sums the scales towards a sort of like center right liberalism. And to me, when people talk about the Blitz spirit, my grandmother on my mother's side was not a survivor of the London Blitz, but rather the Norwich Blitz. She had meningitis and was left in an iron lung in a hospital overnight because she couldn't evacuate the shelters when she was 6 years old. So they turned the fucking lights off and left a six-year-old in an iron lung while the Germans bombed the city of Norwich. She was never a sane person. She was always erratic. She got pregnant when she was 15. She got married. She moved to America with my grandfather. Like, she was always erratic. Like, her life was inexorably negatively affected by the Blitz. So when people talk about the Blitz spirits, I'm like, you do realize that like a lot of people weren't better because of it. In fact, everyone was worse off because of it.
Yeah.
And it's just wild, like everywhere around here, like all these, you know, housing estates were built because the place was bombed out. Like the idea that there's something noble and ideal about it, it's like the Blitz spirit is the government abandoning people to no bomb shelters and people deciding to force their way into the tube to shelter, which embarrassed the government. They didn't want to let them. Like, just the sheer volume of that myth making, like, I we'll always probably wind up taking time to gang up and make fun of British stuff. But I think that that myth-making, that mythology, that unwillingness to face the past or the present, I feel like that is...
Yeah, well, in the US, it's how we talk about civil rights, right? Like, yes. We talk about civil rights like it was a non-violent thing, and we don't talk about the Black Panthers, and we don't talk about, like, Rob Williams, right? He wrote his book, Negroes with Guns. We don't talk about people fighting the cops. We don't talk about the people who were killed during the civil rights struggle, right? We present it like these guys went for a walk in Birmingham and Selma, and then there was some fire hosing, which was very unpleasant. A couple of people got bitten by dogs, and then we realized that racism was bad, and now it's gone. Like, and that's how, like, I get wildly frustrated with history textbooks when I teach in the US.
Yeah.
Because it's fucking reprehensible that we don't... Or Stonewall, right? Like, yeah, it wasn't like... no one was doing that so you could have a rainbow-colored Pepsi can.
I mean, I'm reading Mike Davis's Set the Night on Fire right now and reading about, like, students from... high school and college students from the Los Angeles era going and doing freedom rides and, like, getting paralyzed.
Yeah.
Like, dying in prisons in Mississippi. And it's like... You know, and this was one after another after another. It wasn't like one person got hurt and everyone's like, wow, racism sure is bad in the South. Like, they were brutalizing these people and they had to keep sending more and keep sending more because, like, unless they kept the pressure up, people would forget that it existed. The right. idea that, like, the civil rights was just a snap your fingers thing or that it was achieved without the threat of violence, like...
Yeah, both of those things are completely untrue, right? But we do our young people a disservice when we tell them that, like, they can change the world by asking nicely. And, like, it's the biggest lie the state tells, and it's pretty bloody obvious why it tells it, right? Like, but it, yes, it's the same here with how we talk about World War II and the Blitz spirit.
Or the British Empire.
Yes. Yeah.
Whole other episode we can get into about those mythologies. But James, thank you so much for making time for this. This has been a really, really great conversation for me, and I hope our fans, our listeners have enjoyed it as well. I would love to get you back on here. Time zone difference is kind of a killer, but we make it work one way or the other, man.
Yeah, that'd be cool. I'd love to do that.
And I'd love to give you a chance to plug your work or places where people can find you.
Yeah, absolutely. So I have a Twitter. It's just my name, James Stout, JamesStout. I have a Patreon too, where I do some like writing about history. And then I do a lot of investigative stuff too, about the broader spectrum of cops and chuds and cops who are chuds. Which you can find, normally I'll just tweet when I write something, so you can probably find it there. Those would be the two places to find me right now. Yeah, please do get in touch. I've written a book. Sorry, I'm really bad at that. I've written a book. I don't get any money when you buy it, actually, because it's an academic book, but you still can. If you can't afford it, then please let me know, because your library should have it for free, and if they don't, I'll make sure they do. You don't need to buy it. It's really expensive, I understand. But you should read it if you can, because I think it's important to learn about the history of anti-fascism. So it's called The Popular Front in the 1936 Barcelona Olympics, Playing as If the World Was Watching.
Awesome, man. Well, like I said, I will find the link to that and link to it in the show notes as well as to your Patreon. And thank you so much for being on today.
Cool. Thank you, man. Enjoyed it.